Welcome to the genitourinary system. For this body system, we're going to focus on uncomplicated urinary tract infections, urinary incontinence, and Foley catheters. Here are our objectives for this lesson. We're going to understand the basic anatomy and physiology, pathophysiology, signs and symptoms, risks and predispositions of adults and elderly patients with bladder disorders. We're going to use the nursing process to care for adult and elderly patients with bladder disorders. We're going to incorporate knowledge of labs and medications consistent with the cause and treatment of adult and elderly patients with bladder disorders. And we're going to provide patient education to promote and maintain the health of the adult and the elderly patients with bladder disorders. We're going to start with a review of the GU anatomy and physiology. Each block is going to build upon this information that you learned in your prereqs. So you're probably going to review this again later on as you get through the higher level blocks. The organs of the GU system include the kidneys, ureter, bladder, and urethra. These all work together to regulate fluid and electrolytes, filter and remove waste products from the body, provide the hormones involved with red blood cell production, and help control our blood pressure. The kidneys are the main organ in the GU system, doing the majority of the work for all of these. The kidneys are like a special filter for our blood. The kidneys sense if the blood has too many waste products, electrolytes, or fluids, and excretes them into the urine and out of the body. The kidneys can also do the opposite and will hold on to any of these things if the body needs them and won't excrete them into the urine. The kidneys also sense how many red blood cells we have, and if we don't have enough, they'll send hormones to tell the long bones of the body to produce more red blood cells. Most of this occurs in the nephrons inside the kidneys. Once the nephrons filter out what's not needed, it's turned into urine. The urine then travels down the ureters and drains into the bladder. The bladder is a sac made of smooth muscle that is innervated or controlled by the autonomic nervous system. The bladder is made to be a temporary reservoir for the urine until the body releases it through the urethra and out of the body. In males, the urethra functions to excrete the urine and is part of the reproductive system. For males, the urethra is anywhere from 5 to 6 inches long and is external to the body. In females, the urethra is about 1.5 to 2.5 inches long and only serves for excretion of urine. No part of the female urethra is external. This information is important to consider when we discuss urinary tract infections later on. The internal structure of the kidneys is very complex, and it's honestly the most sensitive organ in our body. Because the kidney turns over our entire volume of blood every 30 minutes, it can easily be damaged by changes in blood pressures, medications, excess waste products in our blood. And inside the kidney, we have about 1 million nephrons that do the work of filtering the blood and creating the urine. They have a large blood supply and work hard to filter out small molecules. Sometimes, if the kidneys need to filter out large molecules like blood cells or albumin, which is a protein molecule, it can do so without causing any damage, but if it has to filter out a lot of these large molecules, the nephrons will become damaged. The nice thing about the kidneys is because there are so many nephrons, the kidneys can handle having about 80% of the nephrons damaged before we have to start artificially filtering out the blood for the person. As we age, the nephrons do die. About 30 to 50% of them die by the time we're 70 years old. So we want to make sure we preserve as many of the nephrons we can as healthcare workers by watching kidney function studies when we give patients medications that could damage their kidneys. We have a classification of medications called diuretics that are special medications we give to a person who has too much fluid in their blood, and the medications make the person excrete the extra fluid in their urine. Some of these diuretics work in the loop of Henle, and we call these loop diuretics, and some of these work in the distal convoluted tubule, and they tell the kidneys to excrete more sodium, and where sodium goes, water follows, so it makes the person excrete extra fluid. These are called thiazide diuretics. The other type of diuretic is called a potassium-sparing diuretic, and they also work in the distal convoluted tubule, causing the kidneys to excrete extra sodium, but they also block aldosterone, causing more sodium to be excreted and therefore more fluid to be excreted. The RAS system is an incredibly important system in the body when it comes to blood pressure control and fluid and electrolyte balance. The RAS system stimulates vasoconstriction and aldosterone release to make the kidneys retain water to increase blood volume and increase blood pressure. This system will come up again in fluid and electrolytes and in cardiac, so I wanted to give you a good explanation, and there's no way I can do that over PowerPoint. So I've added a link to this wonderful video that explains it slowly and thoughtfully. Please spend the 14 minutes watching this video. It'll be very helpful for you to help understand the RAS system, and it's going to help you out with a lot of other diseases and issues and medications in later blocks. The medical term for going pee or urinating, and commonly is called voiding, is called micturition. Micturition is controlled by the bladder and the bladder's unique muscular design. The bladder is composed of three layers of muscle tissue called the detrusor muscle. The detrusor muscle layers are called the inner longitudinal layer, the middle circular layer, and the outer longitudinal layer. These layers sense the amount of urine in the bladder by determining the epithelial layer, how much it's been stretched out. When the epithelial layer is stretched out, the detrusor muscle contracts or squeezes, the internal urethra sphincter relaxes, opening up to allow urine to flow down the urethra, causing the perineal muscle to relax, which causes the external sphincter to relax. The abdominal wall muscles contract, the diaphragm lowers, and the urine exits the urethra into the toilet. Typically, once a person has become potty trained, meaning they've gained voluntarily control of this process becomes completely voluntary. We, our bodies, our brains, tell the body when it's time to go pee. Some conditions can affect voluntary control, like older age, fluid intake, activity levels and muscle tone, medications like diuretics, psychosocial conditions like anxiety, and some neurological disorders can affect this voluntary control. I mentioned older age as a reason why people can lose voluntary control of their urination and have nephron death. Since we discuss older adults a lot in block one, let's go a little deeper into this. I already mentioned the fact that nephrons start to die and we'll lose almost half of them by the time we reach 70 years old. This can happen because the arteries leading to the kidneys and feed the kidneys with their blood supply can get sclerosed or hardened with age, and that slows down the blood flow to the kidneys. Because the blood flow is decreased, the filtering ability to the kidneys decreases and the waste in the blood start to increase, causing fluid volume changes and electrolyte imbalances. This makes the nephrons have to filter harder when they do get the blood, and when they work harder, they work less efficient. Remember when I said those kidneys are sensitive? They don't like working harder, and that makes them more damaged. Older adults also have less thirst, so they get dehydrated easier, which increases sodium levels in the blood, which makes the kidneys work hard to excrete the extra sodium. They don't like this either. On top of this, older people usually have more medical problems, which means they take more medications. If you remember from pharmacology, the kidneys help excrete metabolized medications. Some medications like ibuprofen and some antibiotics are hard for the kidneys to excrete, and they can cause kidney damage. If the kidneys can't excrete the medications effectively, those medications can start to increase their levels in the blood. They can cause drug interactions, toxicity, which then causes more kidney damage. If all of this wasn't enough, old age also changes how well the bladder muscles work, causing some people to have urination at night, called nocturia. Some people have increased frequency of urinating. Some people's muscles stop responding to the sense of needing to pee, and then they can't empty their bladder, which is called urinary retention. Some people's sphincters stop relaxing voluntarily, causing the urine to come out whenever it wants to, and this is called urinary incontinence. Now we're going to move into how we assess the GU system. The first part of any nursing assessment is when we ask the patient all kinds of questions related to their GU system. We want to ask them about their usual patterns for urinary elimination. How often do they urinate and how much comes out? Has there been any changes to their urinary pattern? Well, we want to ask them if they need to take any medications or do anything special to help them urinate. I mentioned psychosocial issues in urination, like anxiety. Some people cannot urinate at all if other people are around and can hear. So the person may need to be completely alone to be able to urinate. Some people may need to push on their abdomen to be able to start urinating. Some people may need water running. We need to know about all of this. We also need to know if they had any issues in the past, like diseases, trauma, or surgeries that could affect urination. We want to know if they have any urinary symptoms like pain, burning, dribbling, or incontinence. We need to know all of their medications they take, especially the ones that may affect kidney function, but most people don't know which ones do that, so we just want to know all of them. We want to know about the types of fluids they ingest and how much, as well as their diet, especially protein intake. Diets high in protein can cause kidney damage because albumin molecules are very large. We also want to know about any allergies they have to medications and to non-medications. It's kind of difficult to do a physical exam on some of the organs of the GU system, so a lot of what we do assess is going to be other body systems that are affected by the kidneys. We can't physically assess the kidneys because they're internal, but there are some physical exams higher level healthcare providers can do. To assess the bladder, we can palpate the bladder to see if it feels like it's distended. We can also use a bladder scanner to see how much urine is sitting in the bladder. Sometimes we'll need to do a post-void residual bladder scan. We would have the patient fully empty their bladder, and then we would do a bladder scan to see how much urine is left in the bladder. We can inspect the urethral orifice for any signs of infection, redness, discharge, or odor, and we can also inspect the urine itself. Whenever we empty a commode or a urinal or a Foley catheter, we should always be inspecting the urine. We want to look at the color, the clarity, look for any sediment, while also smelling it for any odors. And then, although the skin doesn't necessarily relate back to GI, the skin can tell us a lot about a person's fluid status. So we want to look at their skin color, their skin turgor, we want to check for any edema, and we want to check those mucous membranes. All of these are going to tell us if the patient is well hydrated, overhydrated, or dehydrated. We also want to assess vital signs like the heart rate and the blood pressure because these are good indicators of fluid status. There are a lot of diagnostic studies we can do to look at the GU system. I listed out a bunch for you here, but what I want for you to really know in block one is a KUB, which is an X-ray of the kidneys, ureter, and bladder, CT scans, renal function studies, and urinalysis. The KUB is an X-ray that's used to look at the abdomen in general. Its location is from the diaphragm down to the top of the pubic bone, so it gets a great picture of the whole abdomen, including the kidneys, ureter, and bladder. X-rays look at structures, specifically bony structures. So an X-ray won't see any tissue damages, but if there's something blocking the GU tract, like a stone that's made out of calcium, calcium is the same thing that bone is made out of, so the KUB will show that stone. If we're looking for tissue structure changes, the provider might order a CAT scan or a CT scan. The CT scan looks at the tissues and organ structures and can see more detail of what's going on. The big thing about CT scans is most of them require contrast to be either injected IV or ingested orally to see those structures in more detail. And unfortunately, that contrast can damage the kidneys, especially if the patient takes some specific medications that we'll talk about later in this semester, or if the patient already has kidney damage, or if the patient has an allergy to shellfish or contrast dye. So a CT scan can damage the kidneys. If the CT scan does not show enough detail, the provider can send the person for an MRI, which can see very tiny, very detailed parts of the structures. In addition to these imaging studies, we can do blood and urine tests to check on the kidneys. A urinalysis is a lab test that's done on the urine itself. We collect the urine in a non-contaminated, preferably sterile container, and we send it to the lab. If the person is voiding or urinating, we have them do a clean catch or a midstream catch that you saw when you guys were watching nursing skills videos. We can send it as a one-time voiding sample, or we can do a 24-hour sample where we save every drop of urine they make in a big container and we send it all to the lab at the end of 24 hours. A non-24-hour urinalysis is going to be looking at and will result the urine color, the urine clarity, the pH, the urine specific gravity, and the urine osmolality. If there are any glucose, protein, ketones, white blood cells, red blood cells, bacteria, or nitrites present, those will be resulted as well. If there are white blood cells and bacteria present, the lab will send the urine for a culture and sensitivity. The culture is to see what type of bacteria is growing in the urine, and the sensitivity is going to determine what type of antibiotics that particular bacteria will be killed by. The culture and sensitivity normally takes about 72 hours to be resulted because they have to wait for the bacteria to grow. The 24-hour urinalysis doesn't look at the same things. It's normally looking at how well the kidneys excrete creatinine, sodium, urea, or phosphorus over a 24-hour period of time. So the lab is actually counting how much of those waste products are in that urine, and it's going to give them a good idea of how much that patient is able to excrete in 24 hours. There are three main serum or blood tests that we can do to check on the kidneys: BUN, creatinine, and GFR. BUN, or blood urea nitrogen, checks the levels of the nitrogen fraction of urea, which is a waste product from protein metabolism. BUN reflects protein intake and the kidney's ability to excrete the waste of the protein. However, BUN is not very sensitive to kidney damage. It's a good test, but it's not the best. Creatinine is a much more sensitive test for kidney function and kidney damage. It measures the non-protein waste products of creatinine metabolism. It's proportional to muscle body mass. So if you look at the slide, you'll see that the male versus female normal values are different, and that's to take into account the muscle mass differences in the two sexes. GFR, or glomerular filtration rate, is a test that shows us how well the kidneys are filtering blood by the kidneys in mLs per minute. So how many mLs of blood per minute are the kidneys filtering? It's calculated using the serum creatinine while taking into account the age, the sex, and the race of that specific person. The serum value is just an estimation. The best way to get an actual GFR is to do that 24-hour urine test, and that's going to give them exactly what the GFR is. We use the GFR to stage kidney disease. Normal GFR is going to be anywhere above 90 mLs per minute, so 90 and higher. The lower the number starts to go, the more damage a person has. And if you look at the picture here, once a person starts to get about 30 mLs per minute or lower, like 15-0, that's when we're going to say this patient's completely in kidney failure and they probably need to go on some sort of artificial filtering. So, medications that we give our patients have an effect on the way our urine looks. And I've already told you we should be assessing our urine, and one of those things we assess for is color. So here are some of the common block 1 related medications that our older adults and adults will take and how they affect the urine color. Diuretics, which are those medications that make people pee out a lot of fluid, because it makes them urinate a lot and quickly, the urine's going to look very, very pale yellow, sometimes even completely clear like water. Anticoagulants, which are blood thinners, they can turn the urine red from having red blood cells in the urine. And this is not a good color change. We don't like red urine. Peridium, which is a medication you'll talk about when we talk about UTIs, turns the urine bright orange to a reddish orange. It looks like orange soda, like Fanta orange soda color. And then B-complex vitamins can turn the urine green or blue-green color. This is the end of part 1 of Introduction to GU System.